what names come to our mind when we hear the term breakthrough innovations? Probably 3M, Minnesota Mining Mineral Corporation, and they introduce more than one product every day, more than 300 products every year. And probably in Google, Apple, they introduced the iRevolution, with starting with Steve Jobs, and DuPont Performance Polymers. And in the East, probably Sony and Sharp, which are household names in India. Why is it we don't think of any Indian organizations as innovative corporations? Probably because we are very critical of ourselves. We don't trust that we are capable of innovations. And we are in too much awe of the developed world. And for this small presentation, let us define the term, what is breakthrough innovations, in a simple way. It is creation of highly significant improvement of performance in products that benefit common man. Having agreed, we'll proceed further. What do these innovators do to achieve their dreams? They first find answers to three questions. Number one question is, what is desirable to the user? Number two, what is possible with technology? And number three, what is viable in the marketplace? Because it should be economically viable and the organization should thrive. And the intersection area of these three circles is the sweet spot of innovation. So the sweet spot of breakthrough innovation is the intersection of all these three questions, answers to these questions. What is desirable to the user? What is possible with technology? And what is viable in the marketplace? And for any innovations that to happen, there are three things, three I's. Number one is the idea. Number two is implementation. And number three is the impact. If the idea alone is there, if it is not implemented, it's not going to be an innovation. Even if it's implemented, and if there is no impact, that's not an innovation. Now, breakthrough innovations, they get into new areas. And how do they make the seemingly impossible possible? Through deep insight. And how do they get access to these insights? Now, that is the answer. The presentation will be the answer. Now, I will talk from personal experience with TVS. The year 1973, month October, there was a 21-day war between the Arabs and the Israelis, which the Arabs lost as usual. And then OPEC ganged up and increased the price of petroleum products. I remember we used to pay 1 rupee 50 paisa per liter of petrol. Within a short time, we were paying 4 rupees 50 paise. And with the result, I had to sell my car, which I had for 1 year and 5 days only. I had changed back to motorcycle. T.S. Srinivasan was the fifth son of T.V. Sundaram Iyengar. He thought of motorizing Indians by not cars, but by mopeds. And he thought of motorizing Indians with a moped. That is, husband, wife, two children can move about on a moped. Moped is a French word. Mo stands for motor, that is engine. Ped stands for pedal. It's a motorized bicycle. You can start the engine with a pedal, and you also assist it on a gradient as a single seater. By definition, it is a single seater. So he thought, for the first time in the world, he thought of a two-seater moped, which is a contradiction of terms. He applied to Government of India. Those days, we had several very strict policies. You can't diversify into new areas without getting Government of India approval. And Sundaram Clayton, of which he was the chairman, was manufacturing truck brake systems. And that is the only factory manufacturing truck brakes in India. And with the result, in the 70s, when Sundaram Clayton for the first time and probably for the last time went on strike for 3 months, the entire truck production of India came to a grinding halt because there was no other supply. So it was considered, it was a MRTP company and a FERA company. MRTP means Monopoly and Restrictive Trade Practices Act. In the 70s, what was a monopoly? The definition was, if you had enjoyed 20% or more of market share of any product, then you are considered a monopoly. and your activities will be closely monitored, and you can't diversify into new areas. And Foreign Exchange Regulation Act, FERA, it was a FERA company also, because we had to import the technology from UK. And he applied to Government of India saying that he will manufacture mopeds to motorize Indians. And they said, Government of India said, we'll give 5 conditions. Number one, first condition was that the design must be indigenous. The second condition was no part shall be imported. And the third condition was no machine to manufacture any part shall be imported. And the fourth condition was this is a new idea which is not proven, and so roadworthiness must be proved by Government of India. So you have to make a prototype and submit it to them, to Automotive Research Association of India, who will test it for its roadworthiness, and only after certification you will be issued with what is known as industrial license. And then the fifth condition was that 40% of the total production must be exported from the third year of commercial manufacturing. Anybody in his normal senses would have said thank you and walked off. Not Cheema. Without batting any eyelid, he said, yes, we'll agree to all your conditions. He appointed my boss. We were working together in a small company manufacturing small 35cc petrol engines for spraying agricultural pesticides. He was the technical director, I was the works manager. Then he was called project manager, and I followed suit as a senior development engineer. It took us 2 years to make the first prototype. 76 October 4th, I joined. And September 78, it was ready. So we gave it to ARA. They tested over 10,500 kilometers and certified it as roadworthy. And all his close associates of Mr. Cheema were advising him against this project. They said, see, you got customers as big companies like Telco and Ashok Leyland. Why do you want to have small customers as your small people as customers? He was steadfast in his decision. In that year, the national production of mopeds was, single-seater moped was only 35,000. He asked us to make the plant and machinery for 200,000. And we discounted his figure and made it for 100,000. When he saw the plan, he asked, what is the capacity? We said 100,000. He said, take it away. You make it, rework it for 200,000. And his words became a prophecy. We said even this capacity will not be sufficient for us to meet the demand. And 250 acres of land were bought by him. 240 acres are in Tamil Nadu, 10 acres are in Karnataka. State border runs through the factory because of some vastu reasons. On 29th April 79, Bhumi Puja was performed to dedicate that factory. The next day morning he passed away. He was only 55 then. He was such a visionary person. His son, Mr. Venusnawson, took over as the managing director, who had just then returned from States after doing his MBA. And the first year, we made 8,000 mopeds. It was an instant success. And every year, we are doubling our production. With the result, on 1st November 1984, we won the prestigious National Award for Productivity in the two-wheeler sector, beating Bajaj. And it was to be given by Indira Gandhi on the day. The previous day, she was shot dead. The president of the workers' union was in Delhi to receive the award. It was given by Rajiv Gandhi later. In 85 also, Sundaram Clayton Moped Division won the productivity award. I was also present along with Mr. Venusnawson when he received it from Rajiv Gandhi in Vigyan Bhavan. And next year also it was won. It was, once you get this in 3 years in succession, you are removed, you are not eligible to apply for it. Somebody else should get it. That is the idea. And the rest is all recorded history, which you know. And this is Mr. T.S. Srinivasan, fifth son of T.V. Sundaranga. This is what he conceived. And this is the team. This is the first moped which is still running there, which is kept in good condition at Hosur. These are my colleagues. And it is ubiquitous, and they have produced still 8 million mopeds, and it's still going strong. They are producing at the rate of some 3,000 a day, even still. It has revolutionized, it has displaced the bullock carts in South India, of course in North India also. Next, come to Titan. Titan was started by Tatas along with the Tamil Nadu government. It was started in 85. They had a French collaboration, and within a few years of starting, Titan was producing more watches than their collaborators themselves. And the chairman of Titan, Mr. Zarakses Desai, he conceived world's first unique watch. Titan should make world's first unique watch. Then he said to his colleagues, create the thinnest water-resistant watch in the world. Then his assistants, they flew to the Mecca of watch industry, namely Switzerland, and they consulted with all experts. And they were all told, watch could be either ultra-slim or water-resistant. It can't be both. It is simply impossible. They dismissed it as physically impossible. They came back and told Zarakses Desai, this is the situation. Then he said, make it yourself, that's all. And normal watch is about 7 mm thick. So world's thinness should be half, that is 3.5 mm. In 80s, as a comparison, floppy disk, which had 1.44 MB data, was exactly 3.5 mm thick. This is simple arithmetic. And then challenge two, you should make it thin and it should be water resistant. You immerse it in water and increase the pressure of the water to simulate the depth, and then it should work still. And it has a movement which is inside the mechanism and a casing which houses everything. And the casing itself contains the top glass, the bottom cover and the crown with which you adjust the time and the date. And of course the strap. And so the watch movement was to be brought to from 3.4 mm to 1.15 mm, which exactly represents the credit thickness of a credit card. And imagine their condition. So Mr. Dwarakanath, who was the chief technical officer, and the movement in charge was Subramanian Bhatt, they went to again to Switzerland, and they came back empty-handed. And so they had to do, the battery was to be 1 mm thick only. And the moment you reduce the size of the battery, its performance goes down, its longevity goes down. And so they developed a silicon chip to increase its power, to conserve its power, and to go into sleep mode whenever it is not used. And also when it is static. And they developed a new stepper motor to conserve power. And they could double the battery life. That is, necessity is the mother of invention. And then they took the thinnest watch movement to, again, Switzerland, thinking that they would get some help to design the casing to house it. And on seeing this in Basel is a place where Switzerland meets with Germany and France. You can walk to all three countries by foot. And they said, who made this? They said, we made it. Then they asked, see, can you help us in making the case? Because Basel is the birthplace of case design. And they were told, you are crazy, it's impossible to build a 3.5 mm thick water resistant watch case. So they again came back. And so they were told by Desai, so Dwarakanath, Nagaraj, what are you going to do now? How will you overcome this problem? They replied, if Swiss can't do it, let Titan do it. And they did it. How? We'll see. It's a simple arithmetic. Top glass is to be 1 mm normal thickness. It should be reduced to 0.3. Any first year engineering student will know that when you reduce the thickness of your plate to 1/3, its stiffness, that is resistance to deflection, will be only 1/27th of the original value. And the back cover was to be made and crown is to be accommodated within that size. And so they thought, they did the research and they found that they should use a sapphire glass. Now, sapphire glass is much, even though it is very only 1/3 of the original thickness, it still beat the normal stiffness. And they could find a supplier of sapphire glass. And they did not have any standard to fall back on. And they had to challenge every material and every manufacturing process for design. And they had to do radical feats in engineering. And then they had made the case. And then it has got to be certified. Now in certification, there are two things. One is called verification, another is called validation. Many engineers will say, I have validated my design, but I beg to disagree. As engineers, we can only verify our design. We cannot validate our design. Verification means we have a standard which should be passed by our prototypes. Then we can say I have verified the design. Validate means the person who pays hard-earned money for buying the product, he should certify, then only it is validated. Validation means by customer. Verification means by engineers. So it has to pass all these high temperature, low temperature, temperature shock test. You are in an air-conditioned apartment and you are going into, say, Delhi outside, then there will be a temperature shock. And vibration test, bump test, drop test, water resistant. So they found a neutral agency in Switzerland again who tested it and they gave the certification. But I always say all our R&D tests are negative tests. Negative test means if the product fails in our testing, it is going to fail in the field. But if the product passes our, we have verified it, it does not guarantee it is going to be a success because the customer can still reject it. So he made his own test, wall test. He threw the watches at the walls at different angles, floor test, he threw it at floor and he dropped it to the swimming pool and saw. And then he did what I call a Dwarakanath test. He tied it to the shock absorber of his car. In 1980s, Hosur Road was only a test track. It was not a road at all. And it was going up and down and still it worked. So he was now convinced, yes, it's going to work. And of course, the promotion by Nagal. And now it is being sold globally and it is water resistance, unique watch. And it costs about 5,000 rupees and it represents 6% of the turnover. They have sold more than 1 million. Now come to Bangalore, Bosch, a household name in Bangalore. And this is the original factory. And with passing of years, the engine emission standards are becoming tighter and tighter. And they know that the injection pressure of the pump must be constantly increased. Higher the pressure, better is the combustion and lower will be the emission in the exhaust. So Euro 4, we call it Bharat 4, Euro 5, Bharat 5, like that. And of course, there is a time lag between Europe and India. And engine emission standards are getting tighter and tighter. And the crux of the whole thing, the heart of the whole solution is an external high pressure pump. External means external to the engine. CRDI, common rail diesel injection. On many diesel cars, you will see the CRDI abbreviation. And it is an extensive modification of the engine is required and also it's expensive. Both are there. And it produces more than 2000 bar pressure. And PF pump is the venerable single cylinder pump for which Bangalore was made the development center in the Bosch world. And on the right you see CRDA pump common rail diesel injection. And PF pump, the single cylinder pump represented the past and CRDA pump represented the future. And everyone was concerned about this. And Bosch was made the center of competence. And Mr. R. Bhaskaran, he was the DGM R&D, he thought laterally. If only we could upgrade the PF pump to match the performance of the CRDI, then we have a lease of life for this pump and also for engines. And his thought can be given in a pictorial form. Normal conventional engine with the new pump, which will cost only 20 euros, if it can be developed to match the performance of the modern diesel engine with external drive, CRDA pump, which costs 80 euros, then there will be a very good lease of life for this pump, existing pump. And we will meet Bharat 4. And comparison of these two is analogy. How can we increase the performance of the propeller aircraft to meet the performance of the jet engine? Such a big gap existed between these two, but still he achieved it. At the same time, as luck would have it, Deutz is a German company. They manufacture buses and they wanted to upgrade their engine performance without modification of the engine. They wanted to go to the CRDA performance without having CRDA, flute without flute, whistling. Like that. So they partnered with Bosch Bangalore and they said within 3 years you have to develop this. We will not modify the engine, you will only modify the pump and meet the CRDA performance. The direction of flow of technology is from Europe to India and never from India to Europe, generally speaking. And all the Indian arms of MNCs, I am told, they do tweaking and modifying, they do minor operations and adopt and improve to Indian conditions. Seldom they do major operations or developing from scratch for the global market. Real R&D is not being done at MNCs. This is only what I'm told. Yeah, let us see the comparison between the CRDA pump and the RF pump, PF pump. Number of stages, it has three stages. You have to develop the 2000 bar pressure, so it operates at three distinctly different stages. Here, in a single rotation by a three-load cam, the plunger was lifted up and down, so they were able to match the performance. And without doing any modification to the engine, they were able to achieve. And also, it can be fitted to the existing engine, no engine modification required. And pressure performance difference was like this, but they were able to bridge the gap. Yes. And the driving unit was separate in the CRDA pump. It is integral, brought into the engine block. And three-stage pump, you see the three-lobed cam, which generates the high pressure in one stroke and one rotation, sorry. And fuel quantity regulator unit is electronic, so it did not occupy much space at all. And it is not that it was a smooth hunky-dory story. They had their measure of problems. For instance, the plunger seized, and the line, they solved it with the interior lining with anti-friction, anti-wear graphite-coated coating. And they were able to develop it within time and within the budget. And Deutz got the pump and collected the patent because they paid for all the R&D expenses. And what is the comparison? What did it mean for India? It was incredibly simple. It was simplicity incorporated. Assembly, installation, maintenance costs crashed, and it did not require any servicing at all. And it lasted three times that of the CRDA pump. It even outperformed in terms of longevity. And costed only 20%, that is 25% of the cost of CRDA, and it's a tremendous value for money. And all of a sudden, Bangalore Competence Center became extremely visible, not only to the Bosch world, but to the entire diesel world. And everybody wanted to buy from Bangalore. And a new lease of life for the engines, no expensive engine modifications, and it could last up to 2020 at a fraction of cost. This is real value engineering, we can say. And then they did not rest on the laurels. They developed and they came to 25% of the original size of the PF pump. It is called PF51 and weight. And it is the epitome of simplicity and performance. See, it is simple to be difficult, but extremely difficult to be simple, especially in design. And reversal of paradigm between engine and pump. Earlier, people were asking Bosch to match the engine. Now they say, you give me the pump, we'll match our engine to your pump. See, reversal of paradigm. And in conclusion, I would like to say, a saint said, oh God, grant me the courage to change things which I can, and the serenity to put up with things which I cannot change, and the wisdom to know the difference. And O.H. Longfellow said, the heights by great men reached and kept were not obtained by sudden flight, but they, while their companions slept, were toiling upward in the night. Such innovators, through their passion, make ordinary people do extraordinary things. Dear friends, every one of us can become a breakthrough innovator, provided we have a dream and also a passion to realize the dream, come what may. See, Arjuna reached the home of Krishna to ask for his help to take part in the war. And Krishna was sleeping, so he sat at his foot. Duryodhana came thereafter, and he chose to sat next to, at the head of the bed. And when Krishna opened his eyes, he saw first Arjuna and said, Arjuna, what do you want? He said, I don't want anything else but you, my lord, he said. So Krishna said, so be it. And then Duryodhana thought, this idiot Arjuna is asking only for Krishna. And Krishna also said, I will be there not as a warrior, but as a non-warrior, non-combatant. And then he turned his attention to Duryodhana, who said, please give me your vast army of elephants, horses and warriors. He says, so be it, Krishna said. And you know what happened? It is a choice what we do in life, what we do in with passion, which will change us to be innovators. Thank you.